Road to Recovery, the Miller family, the Miller's friends is doing well after brain surgery, Lord. We ask that you give them some mercy and especially their family member, because brain surgery is not an easy surgery and we never know the outcome. We're thankful for that, and we're thankful that the Johnsons have been married for 23 years. They're having an anniversary, Lord. We thank you for that. We thank you for the family, that they are here and they're a part of this church, an integral part of this church to help with its running and making sure things go well. It's spring in Australia, as we talked about earlier, Lord, and again, we're thankful that we have people in that part of the country that are listening to us and are sharing our faith today. We have birthdays, and we have people who have passed exams, and we have cars that have been fixed, and we're thankful for that, Lord, and the Upton's finances, they need your guidance and continued guidance over them as they continue to work toward that goal of finance freedom. Our brothers and sisters at the prison, kids off to college, so good to have those kids here, Lord. Some of them working for you, some of them working for you in different ways. And we're thankful for that. We're thankful for Jordan in Kenya and the things that he is doing. And hopefully everything goes well. Today, Lord, we especially want to remember the Cohens. They are beautiful people. Amen. And we love them, Lord. And we know that each week they go through different problems and different situations in their life. But we want to be with them, and we want to love them, and we want to care for them. And we want them to know that we love them. Continue to be with them, Lord. Give them upliftment. Give them courage, strength as they move ahead. Today, Lord, we have unspoken prayers, some large, some small, some that we don't want to talk about. But, Lord, please be with those prayers. Guide and direct in all that we do and all that we say. And at last, in that great day, when you show your face to us here on earth, may we all be lifted up with you. We ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Michelle, please come forward. I'm going to turn the time over to you. First, you get to be first before me.
Yay. And since I'm in radio, I'll talk fast.
Yeah.
So we've been doing this time of fellowship time between church and Sabbath school. And some of you might be wondering, where did all the food come from? You know, the little snack time we have. A couple weeks ago, my friend Desiree and I were at dinner, and she talked about how we used to have this time between church and Sabbath school. I'm like, that would be so cool to do again.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So one day I was praying. I was like, somebody needs to do that. And God said, it's you. I was like, I'm busy. I don't have time. And he's like, you do. I know. I have kids. And I had just started back to work after being homesick for 9 months. And I really was like, I'm not really sure how this is going to work. I have kids, I have a lot of responsibilities, and it does not make sense for me to do it. But I threw it out there.
But you're not going to quit.
I'm not quitting.
Okay,
I look? Does this look like a quitter?
No, I want the people to know.
I am not.
This,
you know,
is not a resignation.
No, and my word for this year was unstoppable.
Okay.
So you feel better now?
I feel a lot better.
Okay. So what we've done is we've organized it. Patty has helped. We've done what it's called a Sign Up Genius website where everybody can actually be a part. So what you do is you go on and say, I can bring whatever's on the list. And you can just bring that for whatever week is convenient. Or you can say, I'm not going to the store for you. Can I just donate? You can do that too. Whatever works for you, or money is really tight in my house, it's just not going to happen. Can I just set up or tear down? We can all have a part. And I know that you want to because you guys have all come to me and said, what can I do? And that is the coolest part, because when I took this on, I wasn't sure how it was going to happen. But when we put the email out and everybody came up and said, what can I do to help? We knew it was something that God really wanted to happen.
Absolutely.
And that really, the first week when Danette came up and said, Debbie and I are going to do it next week, I almost cried. Because I knew that it was total affirmation that this is something God wants to have happen. So the Sign Up Genius email went out last week. We're going to send it out again this week. And if you're not getting the church emails, let me know. I can send it to you. Or if you want to get the church emails, we can get you signed up for that too. But it's real simple. We're just doing like fruit and vegetable and something sweet because, let's be honest, we need a little blood sugar spike.
We have to be picked up because we got to look like we are enjoying the pastor's sermon.
I did not say that. I did not say that. Okay. The other thing I'm going to say is maybe you and your friend groups want to go a totally different group, or you in a Sabbath school group, or you and whoever, you're like, we just want to take over and do it. Just let me know. That would be really fun if you guys just planned something. And we think that would be a great idea. The other thing is we're not missing church to do this. We come a tiny bit early in the morning to get it ready. It's ready, and then at the closing prayer, we just step out and get it, and we bring it out here. It's really important to me to do this ministry that we don't miss church. That's why we're here. I want to be able to hear the sermon. I want to be able to worship with you guys. So just keep that in mind, and if you have any questions, let me know.
And together we all said, amen. Amen. We need it. That's the way we started. That's the way we need to finish. Pastor, I'm going to turn it over to you. But I do apologize. I hope you still love me.
Still love you, Milford. Just want to remind everybody about, and I'll say something in the sermon too. This Wednesday night, we've been having our follow-up meetings to our series, Apocalypse Rising, on Wednesday nights for prayer meeting. But this coming Wednesday night, we are diverting to have Thunder in the Heavenlies, which is a United Valley-wide prayer meeting over at Cloverdale. So it'll be at 7 o'clock, and we want you to come and be a part of that. So if you'd like to come and just be with fellow brothers and sisters from around the valley, we're going to have a united time of prayer at 7 o'clock on the 23rd. That's your blue insert in your bulletin.
Thank you, Pastor, for not saying anything about me, because you did have the mic. Yeah. Church board meeting, Thursday, September 24th at 7 p.m. Everybody is invited to participate. Remember, there could be some big stuff going on, so everybody wants to show up. What if you showed up and we were voting to close the church?
Amen.
Wow. You might think about that, you know. If there were the wrong people there, they might close a church. So you better be there.
Yeah.
Amen, Pastor?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I tell you what. That's not so good. Okay. Revelation Seminary seminar kind of lined up at Cloverdale. I asked if we could stream it into this church so you didn't have to go to another church. They said that's not... really quite possible, but boy, I hate to see you go to another church, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
This is home, isn't it?
Yeah.
Not for you. Not for you, but it is for some of us, okay? And we don't want to share. There's sheep stealers out there, you know? So you got to be really careful. You got to be really careful. Anyway, word of the day is Jesus, as always. So at this point, we're not going to, is there anybody else has any announcements they'd like to make? Everything's good? Okay. Then the high part of the day is right now. And so, Pastor, I'm going to turn the time over to you, and I'll sit down and be quiet.
Amen. A very exciting element of our service today, and that is we get to dedicate a baby. And Espen Bale. And Mom Malia, come on up, and let's present this little princess to her public. She's all decked out for the occasion. Look at this, isn't she gorgeous? Yeah. She's ready for her close-up. All right. Espen came to us. By the way, we've got some gifts for you, which you'll take, including this blanket that was provided by our Stitch in Time ministry. So every baby gets a new blanket, and I'll put that right there. I'm excited about this because Espen is a miracle. She's got a story to tell. I'm going to let you tell it. By the way, can I borrow your microphone, Milford? Today is her birthday, actually. She's 4 months old today. Came to us on May 19 at 12:50. I guess that was in the afternoon.
Yep.
In the afternoon. Weighed in at 8 pounds, 1 ounce. I think today she weighs a little bit more than that, right? About 18 pounds.
Yep.
Yes. She's doing good. And I want you to share, Malia, a little bit about her name, because her name is directly tied to her story. So share a little bit about how she got her name and then what it all means.
Okay, so the day after Espen was born, the one of the nurses came in and she did an oxygen test on Espen. And the levels weren't showing where they were supposed to. And so they came back an hour later, and after they did it again, and they're like, well, the oxygen levels aren't where they're supposed to be. So they ordered an echocardiogram on her, and Matt and I were not concerned at all because she was happy and she was, you know, just a good baby. She was learning to eat, and things seemed to be going really well until our doctor came back in and said the results weren't what we hoped. And so we were like, what? And she's like, actually, it's pretty concerning. And they had to rush her to the NICU in Boise because they thought she had a coartation of the aorta, which is a congenital heart defect. And they said it was life or death. And that's not something you want to hear as a parent.
Yeah.
So my sister was there, and she ended up calling, I think, my mom and dad. And my mom called Randy, and Randy was the first one at the hospital, and he prayed with us. And then everybody followed her to the NICU in Boise, where there was prayers for all night. And then people everywhere were praying. And the next day, when they took another echocardiogram of her heart, the doctor said it was no longer there, the coartation.
Oh, amen.
And it seems like it's a miracle to me.
Amen.
And so then we were debating on her middle name before, and we decided none of the ones we had picked out fit. So we asked Randy if he had any suggestions, and he sent us the list of probably like 15, 20 names, and the last one, Amari, stuck out. It was beautiful, and it meant miracle of God.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, I mean, every child that is born, of course, is a miracle. Every baby is a miracle. And for Espen, doubly so. I remember that night when we were gathered at the hospital, Matt and I went back into the NICU, and she was in the little incubator box, so I couldn't actually hold her or touch her, but we gathered around, and I just laid my hands on the plastic covering and asked God to bless her. And when I left that night, my specific prayer to God was, I said, God, I need you to be her heart doctor tonight. Go ahead and perform the procedure that she needs. And the next morning, of course, God blessed us with that blessing. And Amari is here today, and so exciting to be able to dedicate her to the Lord. You have family members here, a long list, and Gary was introducing us to everyone. Matt is here, and we're just so grateful that you could be here for this moment and to share this with us. It occurred to me that Espen and My granddaughter Sydney and Tessa and many of the babies that have been born this year are all part of Generation Z. Now, Generation Z, it's interesting because I don't know what they're going to do beyond Z. That's the end of the alphabet. They might start over. AA, I don't know. But Generation Z, it's the last of the alphabet, and it also occurs to me that, you know, we've been studying about the end times. We all know that there will be a generation, right, on earth of young people who will see the Lord when he comes. And all indications are that Espen will be among that generation to be alive when Jesus comes. All the more reason for us as a church family, all the more reason for parents to do their level best to make this generation one that is ready to meet him, one that loves the Lord. You chose as a scripture for Espen the words of Hannah after her baby Samuel was born. And before I read that, you expressed that the reason why you're bringing her for dedication today is because you believe it's important for you to be held accountable to her and to God, and that you'll do your best to teach her and show her the importance of having a relationship with him. And we can all say amen to that.
Amen.
You want her to know that she can always turn to him and that the power of prayer is undeniable, of which she's living proof.
Amen.
Amen. She will always know that. Your life wish for her is that you want her to be happy and know that every day is a gift. You want her to know that she's loved by family, friends, and Christ. And she shouldn't let anyone tell her who she should be, but to listen to her heart. The words of Hannah when she brought Samuel to the temple for dedication was, "I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I asked of him. So now I give her to the Lord. For her whole life she'll be given over to the Lord." And it's perfect because we did, all of us, we prayed for this child. And the Lord heard us. And in response to that gift, we give her back now to him and ask that he mark her and love her for all eternity. The Bible records very little about Enoch. You won't read much about Enoch. But we do know that it wasn't until after he had children that he started to walk with the Lord. Because that's what it says. It says Enoch lived 65 years, and then he gave birth to Methuselah. And then he walked with the Lord 300 more years and had more children. But there was something about the fatherhood experience that brought Enoch into a closer relationship with God. So close, so intimate, that the Lord just said, "Enoch, just come on home with me." What was it about that parenting experience? Is it because Enoch saw in his relationship to his children the relationship that God had with him? And you will know, as you probably already do, Malia, that having a child changes you. It brings you to your knees in a way that maybe nothing else does. It makes you dependent and cry out to God maybe as nothing else ever has. And it's interesting because as much attention and love and focus that we give on infants, well, they're your children for the rest of your life. They'll be 60 years old and you'll still be caring about them. Yeah. You never get rid of them. So today we're dedicating Espen to the Lord as a way of giving thanks. And Malia, by coming forward before God and his people, are you here today to declare your desire to dedicate yourself and your daughter to the Lord?
Yes.
So that Espen may walk in the abundant life that Christ offers, do you vow by God's help and in partnership with the church and your family to provide Espen a Christian home of love and peace, to raise her in the truth of our Lord's instruction and discipline, and to encourage her to one day trust Jesus Christ as her Savior and Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Family members, I know you're here, and throughout the
building. We need you to dedicate yourselves too, to helping raise Espen and give her the very best. It's not just food and clothing and education. You have an obligation to provide for her a support system of love so that she feels secure and knows no matter what happens in life, you've got her back. Do you so declare that today?
Amen.
Church family, same thing. Our obligation is for all of our kids, as Milford pointed out. We do. We have a moral obligation before God to help these parents be successful. It's not easy today. It is not easy to raise children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. We're going upstream. We're going against the culture. And so there's a lot that goes against families today. They need the wider support network of the church family. Do you, church family, agree and dedicate yourselves to that challenge and to be that support network?
Amen.
Amen. All right. I'm going to see if she'll let me hold her. We'll make this fast. Come on, baby girl. All right. See mama? You see mama? All right. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this precious gift of Espen. Thank you for giving her back to us. We all cried out to you for her life. And Father, you in your mercy and grace, you stepped in and performed the heart surgery that she needed. And she's with us here today. She is a miracle, and Lord, we want her to be saved. And so, Espen, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And together we all claim the promise, Lord, that you will write your name on Espen and bless her. We thank you for that cry, because it means she's healthy. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you both.
I just want to add one other side. That the pastor is involved in, and that's sports. You know, we've had the dedication there, but I did get a text soon after she was born that one evening during a game she was yelling and screaming for the Broncos.
Oh, man, there you go.
So I assume that she's going to be a Bronco also, plus a member of our church here. Absolutely blessed. Thank you for everything, and we're going on with our trio.
Okay.
We'll come forward at this time. We'd appreciate it. Thank you very much.
All right, that was great. I love that. You know what? This last week, I had a really rough week starting right after Sabbath on Sunday. I had something that kicked me sideways, more like a 180, I suppose. And I was watching 3ABN, and John Loman Cain mentioned something about devil's rabbits. The devil's releasing these rabbits that we go chasing after. And it's easy for me to see what other people's devil's rabbits are. For my own devil's rabbit, I didn't see it till I was halfway done chasing it. My cat had gone missing, my little kitten, JJ. And she's so awesome. And she just disappeared Sunday at noon. She didn't come in for lunch, and she loves lunch. She would not miss lunch. So I went yelling around the neighborhood at everyone, "Where's my cat?" Out of love, of course. Where's my cat? And through the heaping amount of circumstantial evidence, there was created a devil's rabbit. I didn't realize, but I assumed that my neighbor had confiscated my cat, and the little daughters had her locked away in the house in it. And I chased that rabbit hard and fast, and I thought, sure, I was righteous about it. Like, they lied to me, they stole from, they coveted. And the whole time I'm staring at this rabbit chasing, I realize I'm becoming a devil. This is not a rabbit, this is a dragon's tail I'm chasing. Because it's the person, you're supposed to overcome evil with good. You're supposed to not resist an evil person. You know, if they want your cloak, you give them your puppy dog, too. No, hold it, I'm still working on giving life forms away. But anyways, Anyways, I noticed this is a rabbit I'm chasing, maybe even an escaped goat that I'm chasing. And I'm like, I'm supposed to be chasing a lamb. Where was the lamb? He was right behind me. Thank God for the lamb that's always right behind us. And as I follow the lamb, I become more like him. And so, anyways, I've got the piece of the comforter now. JJ's still gone, but I'm a little more at peace with it, and I have developed perseverance through this, which is the only way to develop perseverance is through suffering. So there's a plus in that, and perseverance can lead to character and then to hope, and we have this hope. If you'd like to stand with me and sing these songs, I invite you. Amen. Amen. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. Failures. Revelations 22 and verse 20.
And it says, "He who testifies of these things says, surely I'm coming quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus."
Amen. Amen. Right on.
Imagining, Lord, what it will be like. We sing from week to week about your glory, but we project into the future when we'll be able to sing it to you face to face with all our loved ones gathered on the sea of glass. And Father, we just pray that we are making ready for that day now. Be with us as we gather together for these next few moments. Let your Holy Spirit be here to open our hearts as well as the Word so that we understand it and we obey it, Father, and that we let it change us. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being our God. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to see so many of you out today and many visiting faces as we have each week during this Apocalypse Rising series. There's new faces every week. And I want to welcome you to the CUNA Seventh-day Adventist Church and to our series. If you're here for the first time today, you may feel like you've come in at the end of a movie. But that's all right. If you'd like context, you can go to our website, our cunacast.org site, or .com, and look at the video archives, and each one in the series is there so that you can get caught up if you like. But we want you to feel welcome today. I want to welcome those online as well. Our viewing audience has also grown during the course of this series, and we're glad that you're here with us today. Deacons, I want you to pass out those connection cards at this point. The connection cards are what we use to pray for you and to find out what your spiritual needs are so that we can follow up with those and help you on your way. This series, praise the Lord, we've had a number of people sign up for Bible studies and express an interest in baptism, and we're very excited for that. So what you'll want to do on this card is to first of all fill out the first part of it, which is your name and contact information, and then just hold on to it through the remainder of the sermon, and then at the end we'll show you what to do with that. Also want to take the time while the cards are being passed just to thank everybody for all their support, all that you do to contribute to the service. The praise team, the guys again, sound great this morning. And Nancy for coming and playing. And Nancy has our furthest commute. Some of you think you're commuting 45 minutes. She lives in Nevada. So I want to thank you for that dedication. For Joni playing the guitar, our camera operators who are faithful, Dan back there faithfully on the soundboard, and Vivian on the slides, and our people in the booth keeping our online stream going. Everybody from the greeters who do an excellent job making everybody feel loved and welcome, and then to all of you just for being yourselves. Appreciate all of you. Part five and final in our Apocalypse Rising series today, Jesus Rising. It was the summer of 04, and I and my wife got to participate in something that was very unique and very special. It was the engagement of Candy to Jesse. And we got a chance to be a part of it. Let me just set up the scenario for you. The situation was, at that time, Jesse, of course, was living in Bishop. And for whatever reason, he had not been able to come and be here for Candy's birthday. And Candy was kind of bearing a little bit of a grudge. She was feeling a little put out. Feelings were a little hurt that he hadn't been able to come and spend a birthday with her. And so Jesse developed a plan of which he would make it up to her, and she was thinking that this was his way of saying, I'm sorry, and his way of making up to her. She had no idea what was going on. So what Jesse devised was a scavenger hunt. A scavenger hunt that took Candy all over the Treasure Valley, starting in Nampa, of course, but then going as far away as Boise, the airport, the parking garage, and to the Castanons over there in Boise, and just all over the place, going from place to place, each destination receiving another set of instructions, another envelope or whatever, saying, okay, go here next. course, she's not knowing what's coming at the end. She finally gets to Pacific Press. Pacific Press, where Suzette and I are hiding upstairs in the Owyhee room, peeking out through the blinds and looking at what's happening, because there, when she arrives finally, is a bus, a charter bus. Apparently it was the same kind of bus that that the choir went on a music tour, and that's when they first started going together. Same kind of bus that was there, and the instructions were that she was to get on that bus. She got on the bus, and the driver was there, and didn't indicate anything special. And then the last instructions, and I think the bus driver must have given the last instructions, was that she was to now make a phone call to Jesse. She made the phone call. Jesse answered, but the voice was not just coming from the phone. It seemed to be in the bus with her. And Jesse then appears out of the bathroom in the bus. She's thinking he's in Bishop. And of course, a long, lengthy hug ensued. There was a proposal. There was a ring. You know, excitement, tears, all of it. And then there was a blanket outside, and there was sparkling cider and the whole bit. And we got a chance to witness it. It was great. It was exciting. And it was all captured on, I have the video somewhere at home, by the bus driver, who was so emotional that she couldn't hold the camera steady. And you've got these shaky pictures of what's going on. But I share that with you to say this. However fun, and it was, however fun the scavenger hunt was, the ultimate prize, of course, was Jesse. And then, of course, the engagement, as awesome as it was, that wasn't enough either, because just a mere couple of days later, we get the phone call, hey, Dad, we want to get married in September. And it was like, oh, okay, September, a year from now, that sounds good. No, Dad, this September. Oh, you mean like 7 weeks from now? Seven weeks. Because they couldn't stand being apart from each other. They wanted to be together now. The goal was not the engagement, and it certainly wasn't the scavenger hunt. It was to be together as husband and wife, and they literally couldn't wait to make that happen. When it comes to Jesus' second coming, prophecy and end-time events can be like a scavenger hunt. Jesus left us some clues and signs of when his coming would be near. And sometimes we get so caught up in the horns and beasts and dates and disasters that we forget who we're waiting for. It's almost like the actual appearing of Christ takes a back seat to the signs of his appearing. Talking and speculating about last day events is more interesting than the one who's coming for us on the last day. As we conclude this series today, I want this to be our main takeaway. Don't get so fascinated with the apocalyptic scavenger hunt that you lose sight of the object of the hunt, Jesus himself. Don't get so lost in the trees that you overlook the forest. Who it is who's coming for us, and why it is that we even care. Do we see the apocalypse rising? There's no question about it. We do, and especially this month of September and next month as well, there's an apocalyptic perfect storm brewing. We've talked about some of those things on On 9/11 of this year, just as the Shemitah year was nearing its end, a rainbow appeared over the Freedom Tower in New York. And at the same time, a thunderstorm caused a construction crane to crash into the Grand Mosque in Mecca, killing over 100 people. Omens, perhaps. Omens or coincidence. The year of Jubilee comes in the year following every seventh Shemitah, or 49 years. In the 50th year, that's when the slaves were freed and land was restored to its rightful owners. If 2014-15 is a Shemitah year, then 2015-16 could be the year of Jubilee. And this 50-year cycle has often brought significant events for the state of Israel. Could the Iran nuclear deal be that significant event as the year of Jubilee unfolds? What about the tetrad of blood moons or full lunar eclipses taking place in an 18-month period that started with the Passover of 2014, as you see, and it will be completed when the final blood moon on September 27th of this year on the Feast of Tabernacles, or Sukkot, takes place. This is only the third time in 500 years that four blood moons have occurred on successive Jewish feast days. The Lord said there would be signs in the heavens. Is this one of them? Some point to several recent natural disasters as harbingers of global catastrophe to come at the rising of this fourth blood moon on the 27th. We've already seen earthquakes in Japan. We've seen the volcanoes that have been erupting, the 8.3 earthquake in Chile this week, and many other signs from a natural standpoint taking place. Are these all in some way connected? And of course, Pope Francis's trip to America, September 23 to 25, on Yom Kippur. It's also being watched. He is, I find this interesting, the 266th Pope meeting with Obama on the 266th day of the year. And 266 days is the average term of gestation for a human birth. Some have speculated that something will be birthed on that day. This Pope has already promoted Sunday observance as a means of strengthening the state of the family and also as a means of saving the earth. But in all the noise, where's Jesus? It's like trying to find Waldo. There's so much going on that apocalyptic ADD is inevitable. But at the end of the day, if Jesus isn't rising in my life, if he isn't my heart's desire and obsession, I may miss the main purpose of prophecy, which is what? To prepare me to be with the one I love. The main purpose of prophecy is to prepare me to be with the one I love. And if you miss this main purpose of prophecy, you face the greatest danger, and that is of missing Jesus altogether. It's happened before. It's happened before to some of the best Bible students on earth, the Jewish people. Despite their knowledge of the scriptures, despite their study of prophecy, they were unprepared for him when he came the first time. And an encounter between Jesus and the Jews following a miraculous healing at the Pool of Bethesda reveals how it's possible to miss Jesus while studying the Bible. Turn with me to John chapter 5. The Lord took me this week to a different place for this last presentation on the apocalypse, not to Daniel, not to Revelation, but to the book of John, chapter 5. We're going to go through it together, starting at verse 31. Now remember, the context is that Jesus has just healed the paralytic by the pool of Bethesda. But the Jews are giving him grief for it because he healed him on the Sabbath. So Jesus engages them in a dialogue, and we're coming in on the middle of that dialogue. Starting at verse 31. If I testify about myself, my testimony is not valid. There is another who testifies in my favor, and I know that his testimony about me is valid. You have sent to John, and he has testified to the truth. Not that I accept human testimony, but I mention it that you may be saved. John was a lamp that burned and gave light, and you chose for a time to enjoy his light. I'm going to pause there. John was a lamp who burned bright, and for a time you chose to enjoy that light. The Jews missed Jesus because they never took John, a prophet, seriously. They chose to enjoy his light for a time. It was fun to watch the desert wild man preach and baptize. It was a pleasant distraction, as long as he said the things they liked. But they could also abandon him whenever he became just a little bit awkward, whenever the message got a little too intense. You see, when the prophet's light got too hot, they retreated into the darkness. Therefore, they missed John's testimony of Jesus. We must avoid this danger. For Jesus to rise, I want to urge all of us, stay in the light. Stay in the light. Even if that light exposes your sins, stay with Jesus. Take him and his prophets seriously. Why? Because 2 Timothy 4, 3-4 says it this way, "For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to what? To myths, to fables, to virtual Christianity, to falsianity, that which appears real and good on the surface, but which has no substance to it. Hearing God's word is never to be another form of entertainment. It's not a game. And we should hold on to that word, not only in seasons of excitement. Every so often, every couple of years, there is another focus and frenzy regarding the apocalypse. We went through this in 2012. Twice. We went through this when the Mayan calendar expired. And now here we are in 2015. And we've got blood moons, and we've got popes, and we've got all kinds of things happening. I'm not saying this to say go to sleep. I'm saying this to say that when the seasons of intensity pass, be sure that you stay in the light. Be sure that you don't let your interest wane. Be sure that you don't allow yourself to be lulled back into some kind of a sleepy experience with Christ. When the hoopla is over, make sure that you're still walking with Jesus. Believe his prophets. We go on to verse 39. Jesus continuing the dialogue. He says, "You diligently study the scriptures because you think by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me and have life." The Jews missed Jesus because they studied the word, but the word didn't dwell in them. Look at verse 38. He says as much. nor does his word dwell in you, for you do not believe the one that he sent. See, to the Jews, the scriptures were everything. They were all in all. There was a saying of the time. In fact, there were several, but one of the sayings was, he who has acquired the words of the law has acquired eternal life. So if you have the words, you possess eternal life. When they would read the scroll in the synagogues on the Sabbath day, they would go to that closet of Moses. They would open and take out the Torah, and they would bring it. And as they would bring it out, the people would begin to dance and they'd begin to sing because these were the actual words of God. They would unroll the scroll and the worshipers would come up and they would touch their fingertips to their lips and they would touch the words. These were the words of the living God. And for a people who cherished the words so much, the problem was is that they began to worship the word instead of the God of the word. They thought that just by possessing them that they had life, but they were not allowing those words on the paper to penetrate and change their lives. And Jesus said, it's because of that that you're rejecting me. You don't realize that those very scriptures that you honor and that you cherish testify about me. The best Bible students in the world rejected Jesus. How does that happen? A couple of ways. Number one, they read to support their positions and not to find God. That never happens, right? We never read the scriptures to prove a point, to defend a position, to win an argument. They read to support their positions rather than to let the Bible speak and reveal what it had to say on its own. And what it had to say is that Jesus is the Messiah. Amen. Your Messiah has come. But they weren't finding God. Number two, they failed to realize that it's all about Jesus. Yeah. That it's all about Jesus. From Genesis to Revelation, it's all his book, it's all his story. Everything points like a laser beam to Christ the Messiah. And if you don't read the Bible properly, if you don't come to it with the right attitude and the right mindset with the Holy Spirit guiding you, you'll miss it. You'll see a bunch of disjointed teachings and stories and poems and doctrines, and it's like, what is this? I don't know what this is. From front to back, the scriptures testify about Jesus. And if we study the prophecies, beasts, numbers, symbols, and signs, and yet refuse to come to Jesus to receive new life, we, like the Jews, will be deceived into thinking that we have eternal life, when really all we have is virtual life, a form of godliness. For Jesus to rise, we must come to him for life. At the end of the day, with all of our knowledge, we must come to him. He's the one who gives the promise. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to me. We studied the Bible to have a relationship with Jesus, not just to win an argument. If Bible study doesn't lead you to a personal relationship with Christ, my friends, that study is worthless. That study is worthless. Let's go on to verse 41 and 42. I do not accept praise from men, but I know you. I know that you do not have the love of God in your hearts. I know that you do not have the love of God in your hearts. The Jews didn't really love God, and that's why they missed him. They love their own ideas about him. They were in love with their own ideas, and which shows us that it is possible to diligently search the scriptures and not have the love of God in your heart. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 2 says it this way: if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but do not have love, and I'm putting in parentheses there Jesus, because God is love, then it says what? I am nothing. If I have the gift of prophecy, I can understand all mysteries, and I have all knowledge, and yet I don't have love, the love of Christ and love for Christ, I am nothing. It is possible to be a keen student of prophecy and understand everything and still gain nothing if the love of God isn't in you. That kind of knowledge is worthless. Look at 1 Corinthians 8, 1 to 3. In the Amplified Version, it says this: knowledge alone makes people self-righteously what? But love that unselfishly seeks the best for others builds up and encourages others to grow in wisdom. If anyone imagines that he knows and understands anything of divine matters without love, he has not yet known as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God with awe-filled reverence, obedience, and gratitude, he is known by him as his very own and is greatly loved. Knowledge alone makes one self-righteously arrogant. Ever known any church folks who are a little bit arrogant? And they know a few things? They may know a lot of things. For Jesus to rise, love God with reverence, obedience, and gratitude. Love God with a sense of awe. Love him with obedience. Don't let it just be lip service. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments, obey him, and do it with a sense of thanksgiving. Do it with a sense of gratitude. Verse 44, how can you believe if you accept praise from one another, yet make no effort to obtain the praise that comes from the only God? They accepted praise from one another. The Jews missed Jesus because they substituted the praise of men for the praise of God. It's been a problem for a long time. Isaiah chapter 29, verse 13 says it this way: this nation, talking about Israel, approaches me only with their words and honors me only with their lip service. But they remove their hearts far from me, and their reverence for me is a tradition that is learned by rote without any regard for its meaning. In other words, their religion has fallen into just a ritualistic form. They come out of habit. They perform certain deeds and duties, whether it's tithe paying or Sabbath keeping or bringing a sacrifice or whatever. It's just by rote to them. They're not comprehending the meaning behind it. And God is saying it's worthless. And they were substituting the praise of men, the praise for one another, for the praise of God. The Bible warns us against that and says to compare yourselves with yourselves is not wise. If you're using yourself as an example, you might want to change that. When we compare ourselves with each other and say, well, I'm as good as so-and-so. I'm no worse than... What are you saying? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What are you comparing yourselves with fellow sinners for? Jesus is the example. He's the model, not each other. If we do that, we've fallen into substitutionary worship, which becomes lip service, tradition, and ritual without meaning. Romans 2:29 says this: no, a person is a Jew who's one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart by the Spirit. not by the written code. Such a person's praise is not from other people, but from God. The praise that comes from God is for the one who is circumcised in heart by the Spirit. You understand what circumcision is, right? He says your heart needs to be circumcised. For Jesus to rise, allow the Holy Spirit to circumcise or to mark your heart. Because when the Holy Spirit comes into your heart and mind and he does his surgical work, like he did on Espen, that's going to leave a mark. And if it's the Holy Spirit who's doing the surgery, the mark that he leaves behind is the mark of God. And in these end times, when we're talking about a mark, we need to be sure we're getting the right one. He marks our hearts by cutting away selfishness and implanting Christ's character instead, the fruit of the Spirit. God must have the heart, or the rituals and traditions mean nothing. There's no substitute for the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And from the beginning, man has had an issue with idols, with substituting false gods for the true God. The nation of Israel was lost because of this. Even as the Assyrian exile was underway, they couldn't break their addiction. 2 Kings chapter 17, 41 says, even while these people were worshiping the Lord, they were serving their idols. To this day, their children and grandchildren continue to do as their ancestors did. It was generational sin. Because even while they were worshiping the true God, they were still worshiping their idols. And it was an example that unfortunately poisoned the future generations. And their children and their grandchildren did the same thing. My friends, are we in danger of following this pattern? If we don't let Jesus rise and let his Holy Spirit do a work of circumcision on our heart, we will end up doing the same thing. Substitution is the spirit of Antichrist. We talked about that, which is nothing more than the spirit of Babylon. We substitute the serpent's word for God's word, a sacrifice of fruit instead of the sacrifice of a lamb, the Tower of Babel in the place of God's rainbow promise, Hagar instead of Sarah, the golden calf instead of the tablets of stone, the flesh pots of Egypt instead of the milk and honey of Canaan, Baal instead of Jehovah, the worship of created things rather than the worship of the Creator, the commandments of men instead of the commandments of God, Barabbas instead of Jesus, tradition instead of thus saith the Lord, distraction and straying instead of watching and praying. Substitution. As the apocalypse rises, we must not let the spirit of Antichrist rise in our hearts, the spirit of Babylon. The gods of sexual sin, materialism, meism, politics, entertainment, greed, envy, arrogance, depravity, hatred, faithlessness, and false religion must not rise above Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Now is the time to let Jesus rise and shine. You see, the most important question from Jesus to those of us who are waiting for his coming is not, will the third temple be built in Jerusalem? It isn't, will Pope Francis impose a Sunday law? Nor is it, will the Antichrist be a Muslim? Or will an asteroid strike on the last blood moon this month and usher in the end of the world? The most important question that Jesus asks us is the same question that he asked Peter beside the shore at an early morning campfire. Do you love me? The most important question in the apocalypse for us is this one. Do you love me? Do I have your heart? You know, you can say a lot about those people who waited in 1844 for Jesus to come. But I will say this about them. When Jesus did not come, they were at least disappointed, not relieved. Their hearts were broken. They were devastated because they wanted Jesus to come. They wanted to be with him. Do we love him like that? Is our anticipation of the coming growing or is it waning? Jesus asks us the question, not only do you love me, but do you still want me to come? Do you still want me to come? I was contemplating that this morning in my quiet time, and I must confess, and I don't think I'm alone with this, but I must confess that I find myself wanting Jesus to come, but I do fear some of the trauma that's associated with his coming. It's kind of like people who say, I'm not afraid of death, I'm afraid of dying. There is, and I can't sugarcoat it for you, there is a lot of trauma associated with the coming of Christ. And it's that trauma, I think, that gives us a bit of trauma. It gives us a bit of fear and trepidation, and we're not sure. We want Jesus to come, yeah, but hear me now. Of all the things that Jesus said about his coming, don't miss this one. Matthew 24, verse 6, he said, see to it that you are not alarmed. See to it that you're not alarmed. All these things must come to pass. It's true. But don't lose your mind over it. Don't freak out. Because I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be with you all the way to the end and beyond. Don't worry about it. I've already overcome the world. My peace I give to you. Not as the world giveth, but I give it to you. Don't fear. Keep me in view, and in light of eternity, the trauma of the apocalypse will be but a moment. It'll be but a moment, an instant. My prayer today is that God will help us not to let our natural human fears rise above our love for him. That the same white-hot love he has for us, that love that caused him to go to the cross and go to hell and back for us so that we could be together, would be the same love that we would have for him. You think there was some trauma associated with our salvation? And I'm not talking about the trauma of nails and whips. I'm talking about the trauma of experiencing, tasting the second death. I'm talking about the trauma of being separated from his father for the first time ever. I'm talking about that black abyss that he endured so that you and I would not have to. That love that motivated him to stick with it, to stay on the cross, to go to hell and back so that he could be with us forever. I'm praying that God will give us that love for him. And that we would let nothing, not even a time of trouble, keep us away from the one we love. You want to be ready for the apocalypse? Then let Jesus shine. Let Jesus rise. He must increase. We must decrease. Let Jesus rise, and if he be lifted up, he will draw all people to himself. Let Jesus rise, repent, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let Jesus rise and confess with your mouth that he is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you will be saved. Let Jesus rise and do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let Jesus rise and get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Let Jesus rise and all men know All men will know that you are his disciples if you have love one for another. Let Jesus rise and do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Let Jesus rise and forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called you heavenward in Christ Jesus. Let Jesus rise and don't become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Let Jesus rise and do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. Let Jesus rise, and we who are still alive and left will rise up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Let Jesus rise, and don't get so fascinated in the apocalyptic scavenger hunt that you lose sight of the fact that your bridegroom cometh. Purpose of prophecy is to declare that there's a God in heaven who is in control of world events. It's to assure us that Jesus wins, to urge us to live by every word that proceeds from his mouth so that we're not deceived by the lying words proceeding from the dragon's mouth. The purpose of prophecy is to prepare us to stand with those who obey God's commandments and remain faithful to Jesus, and to prepare us to be with the one we love. Let the blood moons and the rainbows and the popes and the Supreme Courts and the politicians and the stock market and whatever do their thing. As for me and my house, we will let Jesus rise. He who testifies to these things says, say it with me, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. That's his message to us this morning. I am coming soon. Now you take that card that you were given, and if you would turn it over at this time. I seem to be missing my card. Does somebody have a card I can just look at for a moment? I just need to eyeball it. Here we go. Thank you.
Thanks, Tracy.
Next steps. I want Jesus to rise in my life in this area. So that's a space for you to write where you need Jesus to rise in your life. Or it might be the second box. I have gained new insight into prophecy and God's plan for my life, and I want to stay in the light. And there's four areas that you could check that may help you stay in the light. One, Bible studies. Baptism, small group, or membership into this church. If any of those suits you, you want to stay in the light through one of these methods or more, check all that apply. And lastly, I want to be ready for the one I love no matter when he comes. No matter when he comes, I want to be ready. I want to be ready for the one I love. Folks, I believe that the coming of Christ is soon. I know that's been preached for 2,000 years. Paul was talking about it. Not just 160 years since 1844. This is a 2,000-year-old message. But I can tell you that as we've looked through the Bible and through the prophecies, I believe it is closer than it ever has been before. And the thing is, the question is, it's not when. It's not when. The question is, do I love him? Because if I don't love him, it doesn't really matter when he comes, does it? He can come next week. He can come at the full moon. He can come 10 years from now. If I don't love him, it doesn't matter. And for some of us, you know what? We may not as Generation Z surely will, we may not live to see him come, but he will come in our lifetime. Because as soon as we close our eyes, we'll see him. So Jesus comes in all of our lifetime. Let's be sure that we're ready for him, that we are making ready every day, that the Holy Spirit has access to our hearts, and we're allowing him to change us. Would you bow your heads with me? Father God, we thank you so much for Jesus. We thank you that this great controversy between him and the enemy is coming to a close. Things are still relatively good here in America. But we look at the refugees fleeing for their lives. We see sometimes bodies washed up on the shore because they didn't make it. We see the panic, see the distress in other nations, and we realize that for some, the time of trouble has already come. They're already experiencing it. I would pray, Father, no matter what, that we would not be lulled to sleep. That we would continue to stay in the light. That we would not substitute other things for your love in our lives. And I would pray, Father, that we would keep our lamps, as it were, trimmed and burning. We would watch, and that we would pray, and that we would encourage each other with the blessed hope that you are soon to come, and soon there will be nothing between us and you. Until that time, keep us faithful, hold us together. May we not fear, but may we keep our hand in yours. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. A lot of gratification in knowing that no matter what, whether it be tomorrow, today, or after we die, the first thing we know when we open our eyes, the heaven will be filled with our friends, our loved ones that we have seen gone, and we will be caught up with them. What a glorious day. What a glorious day. Our offering today is for church budget. I would like for you to remember one thing, that every now and then, and I don't like to air our dirty laundry or our clean laundry or anything from the pulpit. However, you do need to look at the combined budget and our mortgage payment and understand that we need funds. It's that simple. We need funds. I can say it any way I want to say it. Dig deep in your pockets. Deacons come forward while they're digging deep in their pockets. And we'll have prayer over what they are going to give up to the widow's mite. Our dear Heavenly Father, again today, we're so thankful for everything that you have given us. We're thankful that we're here today and can hear the message of your soon coming, and the things that we need to look forward to, Lord. We love you. We wait for you. Bless this offering. Help us to spend it as if you were here with us today, and help everybody to understand the needs of this church. We ask in thy name. Amen.
Feel free to stand with us when the plate passes and sing the song.
Was fun. I enjoyed that. Thanks for inviting me. I'm sorry I wasn't on the right note all the time, but I love to sing. That's the only thing I miss about the portion of being sick for a long time is not being able to sing like I used to. I think it's so much fun. It's so refreshing, isn't it, Larry?
Yep. Amen. Anyway. We'll split up for Sabbath school. There'll be a class in here.
Those of you that are visitors, we're going to have a class in different rooms. Now, if you don't sure exactly where to go, ask somebody that knows. Don't ask me. I'm not sure. I know there's one out there, and I know there's one in here, and I know there's some upstairs. So have a happy Sabbath, and welcome all the visitors. We're glad that you're here with us today. Thank you very much.
They're back there. They came. They went to my father's. Thank you very much. Both of you, thank you.
Thank you. wanted to retire early, but then it takes a time to adjust.
Keeps you busy.
Yeah. Now you retire, you know. I don't know how that works. I look forward to retiring, but then people, I have a friend who retired, and he had to go back to work because he didn't have anything to do. So he kind of goes in 3 days a week.
Yeah. Well, it's nice to do something where you don't have to, and you don't feel the pressure and the stress and the anxiety and all those kind of things. So,
That's nice.
So you'll be able to get a better job.
No, I had a job before because remember I was going to go to Cooper Norman, but then they closed the Boise office and I didn't want to go to Idaho Falls. That's where they were. Yeah. So I didn't go, but I got a job with Hyde Bailey. It's a regional top 15 firm. But I've been working there 1 year. So, yes, it is nice. I didn't go into tax. I'm doing audit. It is nice. I've been doing maybe tax on the side on my own, just to keep my mind fresh. But yeah, it's nice. It's different. It's been just so hard with the kids.
I don't know how you do it. How many kids?
Two. Yeah, because then my wife works nice. So I have to leave work, take care of them, and study. I think that's part of the reason why I kept failing. Thank God he helped me get it done on time. A lot of people in need, I think, back home. No, back home, we
So the hard part for me was that they didn't have a support team, they didn't have the resources to do everything you needed.
I'm in the church.
I'm a friend, he's a doctor.
I don't know where those
All right. All right, we're going to get started with the conversation here. If you're on the foyer and you want to come on in, feel free. You can even bring your cookies and peaches with you. If you're in here, go ahead and get settled in. We'll start the conversation in just a minute. Someone bring this man a cookie. Two cookies. The man's asking for two cookies.
It's not such a bad deal, is it? When you think about it, you know, it's not a bad plan.
All right, so this is our conversation time. It's online as well as here in the church. And kind of what we do here is we just take an opportunity to ask Randy questions, observations, comments from the sermons. We talk about applying it into our life. Sometimes we have some good healthy discussion and questioning, pushing back on the material, and so on. So while everybody's getting settled, I'll start with a question, Randy, and kind of kick it off. I heard in your message a lot that, you know, we can get caught up in the scavenger hunt of end time prophecies, and it always feels like somebody's got something figured out that is monumental, and this is it. We can get so caught up in that we miss Jesus. We can become arrogant, thinking that we know everything. We can become a little too self-confident, thinking that we can survive anything because we have the roadmap. So how do we balance being aware of what's going on prophetically? Because God put this stuff here for a reason. And yet being focused on Jesus rather than focused on the latest chart of events and how it's all going to come down.
Yeah. Jesus said, and the Bible says, to occupy until I come. Which means that, you know, you can't be in a state of panic 24/7. You've got to live life. You've got to go to work. You've got to raise kids. You've got to do your life, but you do so with one eye on the horizon. It's like I'm every day, I'm living for that moment, that eventuality. And if here's the thing, if we are ready, living ready, if that's a lifestyle for us, then we really don't have to worry about it. I find that being ready takes a lot of stress out of it. You don't have to worry about scrambling to catch up because things are ready to go. The only time that we really get befuddled is when we have not prepared and something catches us off guard and we are scrambling with our hair on fire to try to make up for the lack of preparation. And that's scary, that's stressful.
Cramming for the test right before.
Cramming for the test.
The all-nighter rather than having studied all semester kind of.
Exactly. You know, we had Jordan's ride last week. Mm-hmm. And this year, I actually did some training.
Good for you.
I did, as you did as well. But I did some training. And it was remarkable the contrast between my performance and how I felt at the end as versus those years when I did not train. Mm-hmm. I felt good. I could have ridden some more. And it was really the first year that I felt that way. And I said, so this is what preparation does. I did. I said that. I think I know how to prepare for the 50. And I think that's what preparation is, and that's the balance. You look at Jesus, and Jesus was never in a hurry, and he was always waiting, right? He would always say, my time is not yet, my time is not yet. He knew he was on a timetable, but it was like, not yet, and he was able to go through his days not in a panic, knowing everything that he was there for the Father's will, and I think that's how we're supposed to live. Live for the Father's will, and his coming will be at the right time. And whenever it is, we'll be ready.
And that's the difference, I think, because the prophetic thing can become legalism. Legalism is that I'm saved by doing all the right things, kind of mentality.
Or even knowing all the right things.
Strength.
Yeah.
And so it becomes like, if I know that's going to happen, well, it's this year, or it's this event is happening, so therefore it's going to happen. And that gives me a sense of pride and power in myself, when salvation is about the exact opposite of that,
yeah.
Which is me relinquishing all pride and self-sufficiency and throwing it into the hands of Jesus. You were mentioning, talking just briefly right before we started about the, you know, I would much rather be beamed up, you know, like, let me be raptured. I don't want to go through the trauma of the end of time. Yeah. And I think, you know, I grew up in the Adventist world, which puts a lot on the end of time and the time of trouble, and it's never as ever has been before, and all this scare stuff. You look around the world right now, there's a whole lot of horrific stuff going on. We've learned how to hurt each other in pretty amazing ways. I was just reading yesterday part of the report, an article about the report of the investigator with Bergdahl.
Yes.
And there's all kinds of controversy about that. I'm not weighing into it, but the examiner, the detective, he outlined what had happened to him, to Bergdahl. And they said, this is the worst treatment we have seen of a prisoner of war since the Vietnam War.
Wow.
What they did to him was absolutely horrific.
Yeah.
Horrible, horrible, horrible stuff. We've already figured out how to do that. It doesn't take much to be the worst time that ever was. But I look back at my life and I think, you remember those times way back when you were in kindergarten, and they started talking about first grade, and first grade is a whole different thing than kindergarten. It's a lot tougher. And you went to first grade, and it was tougher, but you managed it. And then you got in elementary school, and they started fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth grade. They started telling you about how hard high school was, and you're going to have to write essays, and it's going to be so intense, and you got to get ready because, man, you are not ready for high school yet. And so you stressed, and you got into high school, and you're like, well, this is harder, but it was okay because you were ready.
Right.
And then in, you know, junior, senior year of high school, they do the same thing. You're getting ready to go to college, and it's going to be so tough, and it's so tough. But your education prepares you that when you do that, it's like, yeah, this is a little tougher, but I'm okay.
Right.
If we're walking with Jesus, he's already brought us through hell. Because all of us have gone through hell at some point in our life already. And that next, it's not like Jesus takes you and drops you into something you're totally unprepared for. He's prepared you for that step, whatever it might be. And that has given me a lot of peace to say I'm not as freaked out as I used to be about the end of time, because I'm trusting Jesus. And I know that everything that I've gone through in life has prepared me for the next thing. And I'm not that out of control as it feels like it would be.
And it's having a relationship with Jesus that gets you to that place. I can tell you now, if all you have is religion and doctrines, even if those doctrines are correct, but if that's all you've got, I can tell you it won't be enough to sustain you during that time. It's got to be a love. When I look at the refugees, for instance, that are trying to escape for their lives, and they've got their little babies and their little children in those dinky, you know, overcrowded rafts, and some of those are capsizing. I don't think that they would put themselves in that situation for an ideology. I think the only reason why they're willing to put their life on the line is because they love their children and their lives, and they want the chance of freedom. They want the chance of a better life. It's going to be our relationship with Jesus that takes us through. that will keep us from wanting, from not letting go. If it's just merely a choice of, well, this church or the next one on the corner, you know what I'm saying? Or this set of beliefs versus that set of beliefs. That's not enough to make you hold on. It's your relationship with Jesus and the fact that you love him more than anything. In fact, even it says more than your own life. So the most important preparation that we can make for the apocalypse, of course, is developing that personal relationship with Jesus, so that we love him no matter what. And that's really the only thing that's going to take us through.
Got a question online. Arizona, Linda says, I had an incident that I didn't know how to handle. So asking for some help here. My hairdresser mentioned that her wacky mother-in-law told her they'd better get walkie-talkies because the end was coming. She's always telling them about Armageddon. They're not Adventists. They're just basic nominal Christians. I know I missed a great opportunity to introduce hope and our message. I only told her that we can't really do anything to prepare for Armageddon but to be close to Jesus. I did say if she was interested, I could give her something to read that would be simple to understand, but she didn't answer. What could I have said or what can I give her? I feel I really missed an opportunity. I should say she's mentioned this at other times. Her mother-in-law is a survivalist and focused kind of on the end time.
Yeah. You know, don't feel bad. I've missed opportunities as well. You tried. That was the main thing. You know, you tried. And it's amazing what God can do, the Holy Spirit, even when we feel like we have done a terrible job or we've botched it, what the Holy Spirit can have a person hear. In terms of what to share with them, man, I tell you what, there's so many possibilities of what to share. Steps to Christ is a good one, because it gets a person focused on Jesus, which is the object of the apocalypse. And I guess in a conversation with a survivalist, it's like, okay, what are you preparing for? Are you preparing for the transition, for the next life to come, the kingdom that Jesus is bringing in, or are you hunkering down, preparing to survive so that you can then go on? I was on a website the other day. It was funny. I had thought about it all week and did not intentionally go there, but found myself there anyway, which is how to survive a zombie apocalypse. I had thought about it all week. It's like, I just want to see what they have to say. But I never went there intentionally. I stumbled upon it, right? So
sure.
I did.
I believe you.
How to survive a zombie apocalypse.
You were thinking it works.
And it's really interesting because all of the tips, and some of them are tongue-in-cheek, you know, but they're all about, you know, surviving it and then being like, okay, starting over. You're going to be like the last person on earth and whatever. How do you rebuild and whatever? And it's like,
if you're the last person on earth, really the possibility that's pretty limited.
Pretty low.
Pretty limited if you're the last. I'm just saying.
You need at least
two. Helps.
but yeah, I mean, I guess the idea is that you start to ask questions. Ask questions about what motivates people. And you say, okay, what are you preparing for? And what is your plan next? Are you planning just to survive, or are you anticipating a transition into a new life? Because I'd like to tell you about the transition and what God says is coming next. And that might be a nice bridge. And that doesn't make fun of their survivalism and the fact that they might be stockpiling weapons or food, whatever, doesn't make any fun of that. It just said, you know, tell me a little bit more about what you're preparing for. And then I'd like to share with you what I believe the Bible says about what's coming next and how we can get ready for that.
Sometimes getting out of the environment, in other words, you know, the hairdresser, you've got a limited amount of time, you've got a little bit of a weird thing, and if you're able to connect with them and go to coffee, something like that, or you know, and even ask, sometimes even redirecting the question of, you know, yeah, I'm concerned about the end time too, or the world falling apart, but I'm more concerned about, you know, what happens for eternity for me.
Right.
You know,
follow-up, is there a simple book on the end times? The mother-in-law is the survivalist, the beautician is the skeptic. She wants to help the beautician. So is there a simple book, maybe a Signs of the Times kind of
There's tracts that are available on the Second Coming of Christ from Signs of the Times, pocket signs. And you can go online to signstimes.com, I believe, and see an array of little short pamphlets that people can carry in their pocket that kind of give a brief overview.
What's the website again?
I think you can go to AdventistBookCenter.com, but I think you can also go direct signstimes.com.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure you can go there right there.
I did actually hear how to survive a zombie apocalypse.
Did you?
Yeah, there was a theologian. Have you heard of John Piper?
Yeah.
He's a Reformed pastor, retired now. And he's got an Ask Pastor John podcast.
And someone asked him that.
And he didn't answer it, but the podcast did. They went to another guy who's an author. And so I'll tell you, from a Christian perspective, how you survive the zombie apocalypse.
Okay.
Samurai sword and protein bars. So basically, you get a lot of protein bars, and you just keep swinging. And then they said, get north, because they'll freeze. They don't have any clothing on. So this guy lives in Saskatchewan, so he's like, I'm set. Because I'm up north, so they just freeze. And that's. I had a lot of respect for a fairly conservative kind of theologian kind of podcast tackling the zombie apocalypse. I thought that was pretty fantastic. Any other more real questions? Beyond, I mean, the zombie apocalypse is good as well. Dan has a zombie apocalypse question. That's the next series after Apocalypse Rising. It's Zombie Apocalypse. Apocalypse Rises Part 2.
Well, I just don't know how to follow up that. No, what I wanted to say briefly is, all of the Revelation seminars I personally have been through in my life, I'm glad you ended yours talking about 1 Corinthians 13, verses 2 and 3. 2, because it's the heart of what this is really about. Mm-hmm. If you know, I mean, the devil knows it all. That doesn't mean he knows anything about God.
Yeah.
Or Jesus. Or love. And I think that without, we talk about preparing for the end times. The Mormon church, they stock up tons and tons of food in every form you can imagine. But I think what God really wants us to do, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but is to store up knowledge with Him, to be connected with Him. He'll supply us everything we need, whatever it is, if we first go to Him, and He'll deal with it. I was reading in Matthew last week about, with the guys out of the prison, about trusting in God and having faith, and he talks about the birds of the air, they don't store up anything, but they have everything they need. And he was trying to make us relevant to us, that we need to be communicating with him and his word, and the rest he'll take care of. He'll put food in our belly and water in our bodies and clothing on our backs and give us direction where we're supposed to be. He will take care of all of that, and we as human beings have this innate ability to desire to take care of it ourselves. We gotta be prepared. It's not what it's really about.
Yeah, and here in America too, we're different than the rest of the world because we have the ability to take care of ourselves, so we think, because we can stock up on food, we can stock up on whatever it is that we need, survival kits and what have you. Some of these places in the world, a lot of them, I mean, they're literally running with the shirts on their back. I mean, they didn't have all the survival gear and stuff and whatever. I mean, they're literally. There was one kid, one of the refugees, he had 2 eggs in his pocket. That's it. And I'm thinking, we have an illusion of kind of being in control, and that's what it is. Even when we talk about survival for the apocalypse and all these kits and shelters and whatever, we have an illusion that we're in control. Listen, God is going to be the one who takes care of us. And If we can't trust him to do that now, we're not going to trust him to do it then, under, you know, much more extreme things. And ask yourself this question, because I did last night. And that is, I was taking a walk with Suzette, and the moon was up. It's just about at a quarter right now. And I told her, I says, now, on the 27th, that moon is going to be full, and it's going to be in full eclipse. So it'll be red. It'll be the fourth blood moon. And I said, and it's going to be big. It's called a super blood moon because it's closer to the earth than it normally is in its path. So it's going to appear 14% bigger. So it's going to be huge. I said, now, ask yourself this question. If I believed that Jesus was coming on the 27th, what would I do differently? What would I alter or change in my life between now and the 27th, knowing that he's coming? Just think about that. Just contemplate it. Because I think the goal is that we would live our lives in such a way and be in such fellowship with Jesus that we wouldn't change that much. You know what I'm saying? There wouldn't be this great panic to suddenly rewire our whole life. Because if there was a big change that needed to take place between now and when he came, it would indicate that I'm not walking with him. But if I'm walking with him, it should just be excitement and anticipation rather than panic. Well, it's just something to think about.
Questions, other questions, other comments?
Mm-hmm. So, you know, all this anxiety is really for naught. But that's just because they don't have the peace and the walk they need.
Yeah. I think, going to what they've both said, history repeats itself. Mm-hmm. And you look at the Jewish nation, who were exquisite biblical scholars, and they got it off by 5%. You know, they were pretty close in their interpretation of the prophecies by Jesus, but they're off by 5%. I feel pretty confident in the interpretations that you've brought out through this series of the end time, but if we're off by 5%, it's going to look a lot different.
Yeah.
And it's funny how God always fulfills the prophecies, but in ways that we couldn't have imagined.
Right.
And so when we get too confident, into our own interpretation, or even what we feel is a biblical interpretation, we then lose sight of that relationship with Jesus, because he's like, it's all about me, you crazy people. You know, that's what you missed.
Yeah.
And that 5% took you completely off track at that point. Yeah. And we've all got blind spots. We've got to approach it with a little bit of humility and say, my trust, my hope is in Jesus.
Yes.
And everything else will come together. And I'll look back at it and go, that's what that meant.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
And he was dead on. Online question. I have a situation with my landlady. This is from Kathy, whose only experience with Adventism is someone in her past who is a vegetarian and legalistic. They say, how do you know if somebody's vegetarian or vegan?
Oh.
They'll tell you. She used to ask me, to do things on Sabbath all the time, but stopped when I always said no. She'd usually start talking about Mormons and their strange beliefs. She started mentioning things to do on Sabbath again. Then she asked me if we believe in the Trinity. She can be a bit intimidating, as she has a strong personality. I'm afraid if I mention our beliefs, it may become a confrontation, and I don't want that. I'm starting to get frustrated with her and with myself for not addressing this before. What can I do or say in this situation? I've started studying more on where to find the truths in the Bible because I believe we need to know why we believe, yes, what we do, and where it's at.
Amen.
I know this is a long, so I hope it makes sense. I've dealt with this for a long time. Thank you. She calls me her Christian sister, but sometimes our friendship is more like her ministry to save me.
Yeah. I was listening to a program on the radio yesterday, and I didn't like it. I didn't like the spirit of it. It was, I'm going to say, an evangelical Christian gentleman. And he had as his guest a member of the LDS church. And I got the feeling that they knew each other and that they may even have been on the program more than once. But as I was listening, they were going at it pretty hot and heavy. And they were, you know, arguing about whether the Bible can be trusted, you know, whether it's been correctly interpreted or not. Of course, that's a big thing for LDS. I listened to it for about 5 minutes, and I had to turn it off because I don't think that that's how Jesus would have us witness. The Christian guy was coming off to me very arrogant, very puffed up and self-righteous, and he was like firing at this LDS guy like rapid fire. He wasn't hardly even letting him, you know, get in a word in edgewise, and then the LDS guy would kind of come back and he would have his points, and they were going back and forth, and I said, this, who is this benefiting? This sparring match. You don't win people that way. You don't. All you do is cause people to be defensive and offended. And I don't think that's the way to witness. I think what you do with your friend, Kathy, is you find some common ground, you know, that you both have in your respective beliefs, and you kind of start from there. And if you want to kind of pull her in a direction of a relationship with Christ, try to get her to kind of walk through the basics of, you know, how do you become a Christ follower? Who is Jesus? And what does he ask of us? And how can we align our lives with that? She may think that she's beyond that and wants to dive into some more difficult things, but I find it interesting. And I would start really, what is it? Is it John? I think it's John chapter 20, I believe, that encounter with Jesus and Peter. I would start there. And say, can we start from right here? Let's look at Jesus after the resurrection. And what is he saying to Peter? He's asking him 3 times, do you love me? Well, why do you think he did that? Why was that important for Jesus to know how Peter felt about him? As opposed to sitting down and having a Bible study after the resurrection on prophecy or anything else. And you notice that the disciples, they never really quite gave it up. Even on the day of his ascension, they were still asking, okay, Lord, now? Is it time now? Is it time now? And he says, look, it's not for me to tell you the times that my Father has reserved. But let me tell you something. You're going to receive power. That's what I want you to focus on now. You're going to receive power to be my witnesses. And go do that, okay? And I'm going to be with you to the end of the age, all right? And then peace out. He was out. He was gone, okay? But that's, I think, what our focus should be. I need that power every day from the Holy Spirit to live with him and to walk in sync with him. And if I receive that, then whenever he busts open the sky, I'm going to be ready. It's going to be all right.
Bill Hybels wrote a book. Bill Hybels is a pastor of a church in Chicago, a big church, Willow Creek, and he wrote a book called Walk Across the Room. And the name of the book comes from the opening story. He's at a big convention, and he's, you know, he's fairly well known in evangelical circles. And he's at this meeting, and he's at, it's like a dinner, and he's at a table, and there's a guy at another table over, and he looks at him, he's like, "I love your books." You know, Bill's like, "Thanks." And the guy comes up and talks to him afterwards and tells him his story, and he says, he's a Middle Eastern looking guy, and he's like, I was a Muslim guy, and I'm a businessman, Chicago area, whatever, wherever it was. He said, "I used to hate it because we'd have to do these networking and social things in the evening where you go and, you know, connect with people and all that." And he's like, "I hated it because no one would ever talk to me." Mm-hmm. I'd walk into a room and I'm the Middle Eastern guy and I'm obviously don't fit in. No one would talk to me. And so he's a Muslim. Like I said, he's Muslim. And so one day he's at one of these things. He gets there late. He's going to leave early. That's his, you know, MO. Get in early. Get in late, leave early. And some guy walks across the room and comes up to him and says, "Hi," and introduces himself. And they start talking, and yeah, finds out he's Muslim. And he says, "I've been fascinated by the Muslim religion. I'd love to know what you believe. Can we get together sometime and do coffee?" And the guy's like, "Sure." So they get together and start doing coffee. The guy's a Christian, and he just starts asking, "Well, tell me about what you believe." And he just it's a friendship. It's an interaction. And he just asks him, "Tell me your story. Tell me what mm-hmm. you believe." So the guy, over several coffee sessions, I mean, outlines the Muslim faith, Islam. And eventually he's like, "Okay, so what do you believe?"
Right.
And so the guy then tells him his journey, his belief in Jesus. And they become friends. And from that, the guy ends up getting baptized, leaves the Muslim faith, and becomes Christian. He's like, "But the guy didn't come to me and say, 'You're wrong.'" He said,
"Right.
Let's do coffee together.
Yes.
Let's talk." You never, like you said, you never argue somebody into faith. Mm-hmm. Or to change their belief. In fact, there's been a research recently on people that, like, for example, are anti-vaccination people. When you put up media campaigns and when people go and argue and say, "You should vaccinate," it actually entrenches their belief deeper in what they already believe.
Yeah.
You don't win arguments. You don't win this conversation with argument. And what they've said is the best thing to do is simply ask questions.
Yeah.
What's the logical outcome of this? You start asking, "Well, what about this? What about this?" Asking non-defensively engages the mind to appraise rather than defend.
Right.
And so it may be for this, Kathy, that in that building that friendship, and then you just ask, "What do you believe?" which Randy said, and keep probing and keep asking, "Well, what about this? Well, what about this?" And that starts to, they then have to justify rather than you tearing apart their argument and their beliefs. And I think sometimes with this friend who's pretty combative, there's a time to just look at them and say, "Look, we believe in Jesus. We both believe in the same Jesus. I would love to talk with you, but my sense is you're trying to convert me to whatever it is you believe. I'd love to talk with you, but we got to drop that."
You're right.
"And I promise I'm not going to try to campaign you, and you don't campaign me, and I would love to have an honest conversation back and forth and challenge each other. But the argument thing, I'm not doing that because I'm not here to argue with you. I want to be friends, and I'm happy to share opinions and thoughts and open up the Bible together. But when we're crossing that line into now you're my project or I'm your project, it feels dirty for both of us. Let's stop that line. Yeah. You know, let's just create that line of friendship between us." And until she's willing, because Kathy had a follow-up and said, what can I give her, if anything? I don't even know that I want to give her unless she's asking questions.
Right.
Otherwise, you're making her your project just like she's making you her project. And now neither one of you are connecting as friends. You're just projecting each other. How many here want to be projects? Just raise your hand. You know, you want to be a Mormon's project or a Baptist project or a whoever's an Adventist project? No. But I'd love to be friends and talk.
Right.
I'd love to get in dialogue. So
I think if she could give her anything, you know what? Just give people the Bible. You know what I'm saying? Because if you do give them a track or a book or something, it's going to feel like that.
Right?
Let's just open the Word together. Let's just take an honest look at what Jesus teaches. You know, the red letters. Let's go through it and see what he's saying to us for today.
For both of these questions, and we need to wrap up, Randy, here, because it's about that time, but for both of these questions on reaching people that you have a relationship with and you're trying to figure out how to share Christ with, remember this. It is not your job to convince them into truth.
That's right.
That's the Holy Spirit's job. You do not have to have the responsibility of saving them, i.e., if I don't get them through the 20 fundamentals, then they're going to be lost. And I will be responsible before a holy God mm-hmm. for that. Your job may be to move them 3 inches.
That's right.
That may be your whole job is to move them mm-hmm. 3 inches to go, wow. I view my job at the radio station sometimes is just simply for people to go, wow, Adventists aren't freaks. And I think I've come a long way with people at that mm-hmm. point sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't feel like I have to convince. I've had conversations about hell. I've had conversations about Sabbath, all this kind of stuff. And I don't feel like I got to pull them over the line and convince them necessarily and forcibly right. dunk them under the water. But to open their eyes and go, wow, they're thinking something because God's got timing. And that doesn't mean there aren't times that you're going to look at a friend and go, friend, I think you need to make a decision.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm not saying get all soft and passive, but there's also times where you don't need to go in with the Bible thumper bat and just know, man, God's given me an opportunity and it's going to be 30 seconds. 30 seconds and I've got this moment. Or, you know, tell your own story for the love of God.
Yes.
That's not a swear word. Tell your own story. You know what? Man, I hear that you were abused by the Sabbath. You know, I hear that and I've seen that, but I got to tell you, I have learned so much about Jesus when I figured out that there was so much grace that God told me, I love you so much you can take a day off and I'll take care of everything going on in your life for that one day. And that told me something about God because I was so bound up in legalism. Mm-hmm. And they can't argue with that. They can say, well, the commandments are done away. But man, God showed me how awesome he is that he said, I'm going to do in 6 days what takes most people to do in 7. Mm-hmm. And then I look at that and I go, that's how he saves me all the time. I take a day off. And salvation for me is a day off. And instead of arguing and convincing them, you just shared your own story. They can take it or leave it. They can go. I mean, I've had a friend go, man, I wish I could have that Sabbath.
Yep.
You can, buddy. And I know that conversation isn't over. But I also knew that if I pushed too hard at that point, he was being vulnerable. And that was as far as we were going at that moment. And that's okay.
That's all right.
Where are we going next week? What's happening next week? Our apocalypse is over.
We're done.
Are we going to heaven next week? Where are we going?
Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be great? It's like, okay, we're done with the series and Jesus came and... That'd be great. Actually, Amanda's going to speak to us next week.
Amanda, where are we going? Fantastic. All right. Yeah. Will you pray for us?
I sure will. Father God, thank you so much that you didn't let anything stand between your love for us, not even hell itself. And I pray, Father, that we would just, even if we have just this a microcosm of that love for you. I pray that we won't lose you in the scavenger hunt and that we won't just be tossed to and from by every blood moon or every new thing that comes down the pipe from a sense of hysteria. I pray that we live in a state of anticipation and that because we're walking with you every day, Lord, if you choose to come tomorrow, if you choose to come 10 years from now, it doesn't matter. We're already in fellowship with you. We already love you. It'll just be icing on the cake. It'll be the consummation of our hopes, of our dreams. And I just pray that you keep each of us faithful, that we'll stay in the light, that we'll let your Holy Spirit do circumcision on our hearts because, Lord, we need it. There's no way around it. Our hearts are diseased. They're overburdened with the cares of this life. And sometimes, Lord, we get distracted and sleepy. But I pray that you will just stir us so that we are motivated each day to walk and to live with you. Bless us now. Help us to be your witnesses, to receive that power from the Holy Ghost, and show us what's needed at the time. And even if it's just moving someone 3 inches down the road, then hallelujah. Lord, we've done the part that you want us to do. Bless us. Keep us in your care. Come soon, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Mic drop. That was for Dan and he wasn't.